All right, you can hear him now? Are we like even?
Can you hear me? Can you hear, brother? I'm ready to start.
Yeah, they can hear you
11
now.
o'clock.
All right, everybody, we have TeAndre here. And we're gonna go ahead and start. You can go ahead first, bro. Whatever you got.
All right. Well, first things first, I want to dispel some of the message that's been put out about me prior to the video. You did a preview video about, to set the video up, which is good, but you label me as an X-bot and all this other stuff, which I feel is the problem with the gaming conversation online through YouTube and the media, what have you. It's plain misconceptions, but I find it funny that you do that. I don't know why. You can explain that to me first, if you like. Like, what makes you believe that I'm an X-bot and you have any right to just come out and try to label me?
Oh, well, we've had plenty of altercations before, previously, in Xbox Strong. I think that was where we first came across each other, right?
Right.
And we had plenty of arguments on Xbox Strong, didn't we?
No, not I won't say we had plenty of arguments. I will say that we had one particular disagreement. And I feel like as being a gamer, a lot of people don't know me. A lot of people know me in the community. I've got a YouTube channel. I'm not trying to be a YouTube sensation or anything like that, and that's not why I did this, but I come from different viewpoint of gaming. I don't really like where it is today, because of this type of stuff.
Well, what is it about gaming today that you don't like?
Well, it's not necessarily gaming. I'm referring to characters such as yourself that perpetrate that they're gamers, but take advantage of the fact that the gaming community is a free for all. There's no bar for education or understanding for
Oh,
this. So you can definitely take advantage.
now that you
Oh,
mention it, I
go ahead.
do remember you called me like a sociopath or something like
Now,
that.
let's clear the air though. Jamin, I do respect you. I'm not trying to disrespect you. I'm not coming from that angle. It's just I'd like us to be able to have a clear gaming discussion without necessarily using the labels or trying to diminish each other's intelligence, because to me that takes away from the momentum that this generation actually could be. But that's why, like, it may seem like I'm agitated or I come off a little, because I'm frustrated with that particular topic. Like, the gaming aspect of the hobby has been taking a second seat to the arguments and the jabbing. Now, it's all good to root for your favorite or to choose, but to knowingly take advantage of a certain audience, to me, I feel like I think that's what you're doing. And excuse me if I'm wrong. I'm not trying to take away from your opinion, but it would be easy to do that because the PlayStation audience, which I am a PlayStation fan myself, not necessarily a diehard fan. I do buy PlayStation consoles. We can talk about that if you want, but I feel like that particular audience has had it rough for the seventh generation. And right now, they're clamoring for any little piece of news, and there's dumpster diving going on all sides, but that particular audience is vulnerable.
Well, I see what you're talking about, but regarding the arguments and stuff, I think we need to do that in today's day and age of gaming, because in today's day and age, like, things are so different than the way they used to be. Like, these companies
Okay.
are out to get our ass, man.
Okay, all right. I can feel that in a way.
You know, because the more we talk about it, the more other people will see it and they'll think about it too. Like,
oh yeah, we definitely need to expose things. Like, let's throw it to E3. We definitely need to make sure that the publishers have our best interest in mind, mm-hmm. and also the console and makers, Sony, Microsoft, and Nintendo. But when I believe that this particular console round, Microsoft did not get a fair shake. And there's all kinds of rhetoric being passed around. And the people that are in the know that it's just rhetoric. But people that aren't believe people that are in the know, because there's a certain amount of respect with having connections or knowing how to be how to follow the gaming media and credible sources.
How did Microsoft not get a fair shake?
Okay, I'll give you this. Personally, I understand what I'm paying for with the Xbox console, because I would be a PC gamer now if it wasn't for the Xbox console. They've actually invested, and they get their console owners to invest in the experience. Now, that's what this particular E3 was about the games. And the policies superseded that, because the people that were talking about policies didn't have games to talk about. And I don't mean to make that sound like rhetoric, but they really didn't. Sony didn't come with anything at E3 other than attempts to jab at Microsoft on their policies, and they haven't announced any games. The games that they're putting out are not interesting. Not to say it's not a bad console, because I would never tell someone not to buy a PlayStation. The same, but from my point of view, as a gamer with access, they didn't show anything of substance, but they captured what gamers wanted to hear. And I, over the past couple of days, I've gone back and watched some of your videos, and in your video, you actually say that you know, companies hack say things in a way that will go over some people's heads, but some people will latch on to exactly what you're saying. So Microsoft didn't get a fair shake because people weren't listening to what they were saying because there was more flies than shit. You understand?
Well, I, from the way I see it, we all knew what Microsoft was going to do before they even came to E3. Like, their policies and stuff got leaked.
Yeah.
Well, ahead of time. And we already let them know that we didn't like what we were hearing.
Well, here's the thing.
Everybody was making videos about it. People were on Twitter about it. Facebook.
I mean, that's what we
made it pretty clear. And yeah. Microsoft even fired someone. They fired someone for even, you know, confirming some information. And how that one guy was like, well, if you don't like it, you know, too bad. I forget the guy's name.
Here's the thing. I didn't have a problem with it. I had a problem with the message, because once I'm smart enough to where a press release comes out, I don't go to your YouTube page to get an understanding of it. I actually go read the press release for myself. So that's like 1-2% of the people that are even involved in this actually read the articles. Their policy with the DRM was involving digital games, not necessarily physical copies. At the end of the day, the policies for both companies would have been the same if they didn't get sideswiped by at the media press conferences.
Let me stop you right there. Mm-hmm. Do you remember how Microsoft was saying how you couldn't actually trade in your games freely? How you could only do it at certain authorized retail stores?
Okay, exactly. So did they say what retail stores?
That's DRM.
Right, but did they say what retail stores?
No, they didn't.
You only got them giving you the broad swipe. They didn't go into detail. The details weren't even hashed out or done at that point.
That's because what we were hearing already wasn't good for gamers.
But those were
having
from not that,
kind
that wasn't
of,
from
having
source.
That kind of restriction on every single copy, physical copy of a game that you purchase is not going to fly. Especially when you have to be connected at least once every 24 hours to play the game you bought at the store.
Okay, now that was that understanding then.
You buy a console, you bring it home, you buy a game, you bring it home, and you have limitations and restrictions on when and where you can play it? It doesn't make sense.
Hold on. No, see, look at how much you trailed into. You actually went from explaining the policy and then you went into the woodshed. See, when you buy a console like a 360, a PS3, or anything like that, even a gaming PC, you're going to connect it to the internet. If you can afford a console today, you have internet. I know one guy who is actually stealing his internet, and he has the worst trouble with the Xbox One. So I'll grant that. He had a hard time, but look what he's doing to get his internet connection. You have a job, you have a life, you pay your bills. Exactly. So that's what I'm saying. If you have everything, your ducks in a row, your game experience with the Xbox One will not be affected. The people online on the internet, unless they're at the library or stealing the internet, those are the only people that should be complaining about not having online service.
Yeah, and then you embellish that. Still, every console.
No,
look at last generation, Xbox 360, right now, PS3, Nintendo Wii. You could buy the console, bring it home, and play it. No problems.
Yeah. I'm not saying that.
Microsoft completely changed that to where you couldn't just buy the console.
But see, Nintendo Wii has to do that because Nintendo Wii doesn't have an online infrastructure. They have to do that.
They do now on the Wii U, but regardless, you could still bring a Wii U. Nintendo has always been. Wii U right
now. Take us home and play with
us. You can bring it home and play it. No problems.
Okay, now, why do they call the Xbox One?
Because they refer it to as an all-in-one thing.
Okay. Now, they're referring to the market of online enthusiasts. That is why they call it that. Now, I would not even tell you to buy an Xbox One if you don't have internet. Well, like, if you tell that you don't have internet, buy you a Wii, buy you a PS4, and let that be the end of it. Because you're not going to enjoy the full-fledged experience without partaking in online.
What if someone just wants to play games?
Talk to
what if someone just wants to play their single-player games offline?
You can do that.
You can do that now with the Xbox One.
Yeah.
So I can go to the store, buy an Xbox One, buy Rise, go home, hook it up, and play it immediately.
Yes, you'll have to get the update at the store.
So I need internet to get the update.
Yes, you do.
So that means pretty much anyone that doesn't have internet access cannot play the Xbox One.
That's right, and that's what I said before. You have to understand what the experience is.
So it's okay for Microsoft to completely disregard anyone who might have access to internet so that they can advertise and display this all-in-one internet only console.
Okay, so we're not in the Stone Age. So where the features that are in the games, like online multiplayer, that makes the game more popular, right? So there's an online market, right?
Yeah.
So the people that are spending the money are online, right?
What's wrong with letting single player people play?
I'm not saying no.
What's wrong with online being online?
No, I'm not saying that that's a problem. Because I know plenty of people who really want to play Xbox One at home. I'm not saying that it's not a problem, but that's not what their product is. Can we agree on that?
So Microsoft changed their product from what they previously did, right?
Exactly. So
they changed it to an online-focused product, right?
That's right.
So
they did.
What they're doing is alienating all the gamers out there who just wanted to play offline. That's what they did, right?
They're not necessarily.
That's what they did, right?
Offline. You can still play your console offline, but you have to actually go through the steps.
Yeah,
to do
but
it.
As you told me earlier, you still have to connect to the internet to get the update to do that.
Okay, so we agree.
Yeah, we agree that they alienated the offline gamers who might not have access to the internet, and made it an online-focused console.
Okay.
And who do you,
I would never disagree with that.
Who do you think benefits from
that?
Who do you think benefits from that more? Microsoft or gamers?
Microsoft. And the gamers that are into that particular product. I'll give you an example. You can't use your cell phone without cell phone service, right?
Yeah, you can.
Really?
Yeah. I just won't be able to call or text.
How do you do that?
but I can simply use Wi-Fi. I could still use apps that are on there. I could still watch movies on it. I can still...
What do you need to use it?
Well, if you want to use any internet capabilities, you can use those with Wi-Fi. Or you can simply use it at home to make lists or do some processing. Without it,
could you do that?
Without internet, yes.
Really?
Yes, you can still use a phone if you don't have internet.
If you bring a phone home or a tablet home, and don't set it up with internet profile, can you download apps to that particular phone without logging on?
You cannot download apps, but you can still use what's already preloaded.
Point made.
But on the Xbox One, you can't use any features without internet, but you can do so with tablets and phones.
Right. Now,
so your point is that these products are more open than the Xbox One.
They are.
So what point were you trying to make?
The point that I'm trying to make here is that you're overlooking is that you cannot use the full features of any device without some type of connectivity. The market is going towards connectivity.
Why can't they simply let people use their features without having to connect to the internet? There's plenty of features on the Xbox One that you should be able to use offline without internet. Like, why do you need to get online to use the Blu-ray player? Same thing with the PS4.
Because you have to download the app.
You have to download an app to use the drive that's already installed on the hardware.
What about the PlayStation? What about your PC? When you buy a Blu-ray drive for your laptop or for your PC, if you didn't have one before, you have to have the software to set it up. You have to likely register it. Come on.
Well, yeah, when you buy a PC,
only company doing that. That's the point I'm trying to make. And people are
a PC that has a Blu-ray drive, what do they generally give you along with the entire thing? It's a CD containing what?
The software. Yeah.
The drivers.
I just said that, man. We're not going to do no. I'm not in a hamster wheel with you.
And with the PS4, Sony offered a service where they will actually send you the updates on a disc if you didn't have internet access.
Right.
And Microsoft did not have such a service.
Because they changed their policies before it was necessary.
But it's still necessary to connect. And they also do that too.
No, you can get updates via disk from Microsoft too, and if it was necessary, they would have done it.
You still need to get online to get the patch just to use your offline features.
Right, and even though all that's true, you and I both know this.
Which shows that Sony is more supportive of their gamers than Microsoft.
They're supportive. I'm not saying that they're not. I'm not saying that Microsoft didn't make a mistake there. So we're in a hamster wheel at this point. We both know that it takes an online connection to use this system. But what I'm saying is the market that system is tailored to, that is not a problem. See, every gamer that's going to buy a game like Call of Duty or Halo or Titanfall
is going to be
internet connected. And also, that's good for the infrastructure of the service because I've been paying for Microsoft Xbox Live and I'm an adult, so I know what I'm paying for. For example, if you join a credit card and it's a premium level credit card, you know that there's advantages to that, even though there may be an annual fee. If you are willing to pay the fee, you get the perks and the advantages. Now, that model has been copied by the direct competition, has it not?
When you were talking about PlayStation Plus, right?
Yes.
What exactly are you getting that's premium with paying for Xbox Live? Because people have been paying for Xbox Live for nearly a decade.
Yeah, I have. I pay for Xbox Live, yeah.
What premiums are you getting?
All right, well, I'll give you an example. The service itself, the connectivity, the reliability, and the fact that the experience with the console is built around the online service. Now, it is necessary to have that access. Just, and the reason why I say PlayStation is using that is because PlayStation is using the same model, but going about it differently. Microsoft is basing it, making their services optimized. Sony is giving you online connectivity with games packed in, which is not a problem. I wouldn't put one against the other, but Microsoft themselves has invested in making their service, their online system, easier to access for developers. They've given them access to servers, and the systems have only been out for 3 months, going on four. So at this point, we're only seeing the tip of the iceberg.
Well, when you say connectivity, what exactly are you referring to?
All right. I'm referring to the service itself, giving you the ability to party and connect through all of those games seamlessly. So you could have a party of, let's just say, 6 to 8 people. You could all be doing something differently, or you could be divided up however you want, and it's going to work. Similar to how PlayStation 4 works today. PlayStation 4 is an exact model of what the 360 is capable of and is providing. The only perk, the only advantage over the two now that you have to pay is that they give you free games. And to some people, those games are worth it. To some people, those games are not. Me personally, free games are not worth it because I've got games galore. And I know you can't see my whole setup, but I've got so many games. You throwing me free games are not going to entice me over you having better connectivity. PlayStation Network has been down close to 3 times. What, like 3 times already? And it's being hacked and stuff like that. Nobody really wants to be dealing with that, but people overlook it. Now, you guys out there that are PlayStation fans, I'm going to be on PSN with you within the next couple of months anyways. I know a game's going to pull me out there. But let's just call a spade a spade. That shit's clunky. It's not ready yet. It's working, but it's not as reliable as Xbox Live. And it doesn't have the reputation of Xbox Live. And Sony has actually coattailed providing that experience because it worked. Now, it doesn't matter to me if Microsoft is the number one selling console or not. I just care that my experience is good. And people are shitting on that experience out of pure misinterpreting the gaming, what gaming is about, and also trying to justify what they do. And when you following right behind what everybody else is doing, and you're using that audience on YouTube. There, you know, I'm just putting it out there, man. I don't have nothing to lose. I'm just keeping it real.
So you're saying that I am taking advantage of people and...
Oh, hell yeah. Check it out.
Am I saying something wrong? Is there something in particular that I've been saying that's wrong?
Oh, yeah. Okay, I'll give you an example. We had it out a couple days ago. What sparked this particular debate? You were talking about Titanfall. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of... Everybody knows Titanfall is dope, okay? Period. No matter what you're into, that's Microsoft's premium. That's their experience on their system. It's good. People try to throw salt on the game because of that. You were talking about how they should have a dedicated single player. How do you know that? We haven't even gotten the full experience yet.
You should at least be able to play the game offline, or just by yourself, or with
no. You can't. You don't. No. See, you weren't on the drawing board. You don't know why the game's online, and you can't. That's bullshit. That's just throwing something out there.
Well, you weren't on the drawing board, so you can't tell me. No, I wasn't. You can't tell me that there's a reason why it has to be online only.
Well, they had an interview.
Your own point.
The only access I have to be able to explain this to you is from the horse's mouth. Shout out to Gamertag Radio. I fuck with y'all. I listen to your podcast, every single one. They had an exclusive interview last week at the Titanfall reveal. And they had the interview there. They discussed what it is. They discussed that there is a campaign model in the online version. So by you saying, oh, there should be one, I mean, why does it matter that what it should be? They made it this way for a reason.
That's why, for example,
that's a fanboy argument.
What engine does Titanfall use?
The Source engine.
Who made the Source engine?
Valve. No, hold up.
What recent games do you know use the Source engine?
See, the engine is old.
What? But that doesn't. That, that, do you know?
Why does that set the bar? That they, why does that mean they have to have a dedicated single player?
As I stated before, there's no reason why it shouldn't have.
So you're telling me that people haven't had fun with games that are online only? What about StarCraft?
I'm not saying that there's. I'm not saying that they're not having fun. I'm just saying. I'm just saying that Titanfall should at least have.
Okay, so then why when somebody gets that, okay, exactly. So why would I give you the counterpoint? Once we have that back and forth, do you have minions? You know what I'm saying? You call, your boy Larry Ragland Jr. calling me TTE and you're trying to, like, call me out. The issue is, it's all funny games. What I'm saying is, look at the sediment behind the ignorance.
You still didn't answer my other question about.
Okay, go to the question. What's the question? We're going to do this.
What games do you know of use the Source Engine?
Well, Half-Life.
Any
Counter-Strike?
Any more?
Why? Make your point.
Yeah, more recent games. There's some other ones. Name some other ones.
Why? Make your point, Jamin.
Left 4 Dead 2. Counter-Strike Global Offensive.
Yeah.
Portal 2.
Okay. Yeah.
All have online, offline, split screen, co-op.
Right.
And Titanfall doesn't.
And that's because that's the way those games were designed, and Titanfall wasn't designed like that, and it doesn't go anywhere beyond that.
So it's only a coincidence that an online only game that's being advertised by Microsoft was initially being advertised for a console that was online only.
That's okay. What's wrong with that? PC has games that are online only. And they cost hundreds of dollars a year.
Oh, what do you mean cost hundreds of dollars a year?
There's monthly subscriptions, like the new Elder Scrolls Online. They're like $15 a month.
Yeah, those are MMOs.
And they make it that way, right? And it's okay. It doesn't matter if it's an MMO. It doesn't matter what the game
is. Massive multiplayer online.
Yeah, and they're not like Titanfall, are they?
They're massive multiplayer online games.
I'm not questioning what they are. I'm saying that they're not like Titanfall, and we agree. So,
if they're not like Titanfall, then why are you comparing MMOs to Titanfall?
Oh, I see. So, what you're saying is that this was Microsoft's plan to usher in DRM on the back end.
No, it's not what I said.
Oh, really?
All I said.
Why is it an online-only game on an online-only console?
It shouldn't have at least a co-op, offline multiplayer, because it's on Xbox 360.
And that's your opinion, not a fact.
Xbox One.
That's your opinion, not a fact.
I never said it was I just stated my opinion and my reasons why I thought so.
Right, and I say simply that, hey, that's what it is. Oh, that makes me an Xbox?
No, I didn't call you an Xbox because of that.
Oh. I'm a gamer, bro.
Yeah, I know. You play games.
Mm-hmm. So what I'm saying is, if we're going to have the discussion, if we're going to take the time to have a debate and talk about this stuff, I mean, why fan the flames of the dumb shit? Because this is what makes gamers look bad.
What are you talking about?
Just saying anything and passing it off. I'll give you, from my point of view, the reason why this gets under my skin. I'll be, say, at GameStop paying off my Xbox One pre-order. And the guy behind the counter goes, oh, you made a mistake. I was like, what'd I do? It's Xbox One. I was like, you're just playing, man. Whatever. Go ahead. And he's like, no, I'm serious. I got to tell you something. I really got to tell you something. Well, Microsoft is going to raise the price of Xbox Live to $99.98. And they've got the new sophisticated Kinect that's so detailed that they can count the people on your couch and charge you extra with Netflix. Well, now, look, where you get your information, bro? Kotaku, and they've got insiders.
So you're still mad about this guy at GameStop?
No, it ain't about being mad. It's about respecting my hobby. It's about why do how many people have these encounters where you run into these idiots that are just repeating something somebody else just made up?
Well,
and then you have people dedicating whole YouTube channels. Sorry, I'm ethering you right now.
That happened to me. I wouldn't care.
I didn't care either, but it happens multiple times. These dudes talk about, oh, the PlayStation 3 has 2 teraflops and don't even know what it does. At the end of the day, nobody that's out here gaming should be tampering with what's going on with these with the actual devs. What we need to be looking at is what's really getting at us is GameStop. I go in there with a brand new game and they won't let me trade my shit.
So you're against GameStop?
No. What I'm saying is if we're going to get on policies, what we need to do is we need to focus on the policies that make sense. Now, I'll give you an example. I don't have anything against PlayStation. I need more to interest me. I don't need that for Xbox because I'm an Xbox gamer. Maybe that makes me an Xbox, right? But I need something to influence me to purchase that console. Now, they have a yearly subscription. Now, the gamers that accepted that were against it in the previous generation, but we're accepting it now.
I'm still against it.
Yeah? Is that why you don't own either one of the systems?
I might eventually get PlayStation Plus because they have games that I can play. My girl's going to get me a Vita pretty soon. And so I'll have a shit ton of games that I can play, you know, just with a subscription that I can pay for exactly. Like 1 year.
And that's what pulls me in. So really, MLB is what might get me to jump. And that'll be PSP, all of that. But I would never tell another gamer not to make the plunge now. Because you have to pay that subscription to enjoy that experience.
The thing that gets me is that...
So you make the plunge when you're ready.
There's
so
more
telling people that they're stupid or they're
Xbox. To me, there's more value in PlayStation Plus than there is for Xbox Live. Because
well, the
so
games,
like,
yeah.
They offer you a ton of games, and you may have to pay for... And the only thing you're really paying for really is online multiplayer. Like, every other feature you could still use without... PlayStation Plus. Plus, there's all the free-to-play games you can play without paying for it, too. And that's why I don't like Microsoft and what they do with Xbox Live. They've been charged with Xbox Live all these years, and it comes to find out they've only got 3,000 servers running the Xbox 360 Xbox Live servers. They've got P2P servers running every game. And I'm like, if you guys have been paying all this money for so long, and yet, the only game that I know of that's got dedicated servers on the Xbox 360 is Left 4 Dead 2. Now it's provided by Valve. I'm like, what are you guys paying for?
Well, with the games themselves, like with the home console experience, you didn't have it until Xbox Live. And what you're paying for is they're actually, Xbox reaches out and does things with the developers. For example, I hate to keep bringing it up, but Titanfall is they actually had the money to help secure that. You know you're going to get a premium experience. People are saying the Xbox secure. One.
So you're paying for Xbox Live to secure games like Titanfall?
That's part. I know that goes into it. Yeah, don't you? Don't they know that? Don't you? Wouldn't you know? That's what that goes towards.
So. You guys are paying Microsoft $60 a year so you can get multi-platform games.
That's multi-platform games with there's additions. Like I play Call of Duty. I like getting the maps early.
So you're paying $60 a year to get a map that was from a previous game a month earlier than other platforms.
Do you play Call of Duty?
No, I do not.
Okay, well then you don't have to talk to me about Call of Duty. I know what I'm doing.
So I can't talk about how there's bad business practices regarding Call of Duty because I don't
know. No, because I pay for it. I don't mind. Because you're not going to convince me not to do that.
So because someone doesn't mind makes it okay?
Right. I have to know what I'm paying for. I don't mind paying for that. I don't. And obviously PlayStation fans don't either, because they want the maps early. They want Titanfall.
Yeah, I'm sure there's PlayStation fans out there that are interested in Titanfall. I'm sure there's Wii U fans out there interested in Titanfall. But they want,
and they would like for, they would like, they would actually like for Nintendo to step their game up too. What if Nintendo actually came out with a premium subscription service? It would be, especially the people like your brother, he probably would pay it.
But back to what I was originally talking about.
Okay.
You're paying $60 a year to get maps early.
Maps early. I'll give an example. I use the Xbox Rewards program. I get back like $2 or $3 a month already. All right. So that's neither here nor there. And when I buy my subscriptions, I buy them when they're like on sale. Like they'll be like $35. I'll go ahead and buy two or three of them. Because I know I'm going to continue to have that experience. Like I said, I know what I'm getting with the Xbox. Like I like Halo. I like shooters. There's nothing wrong with that. Like you're taking you yourself. I would never tell you that you shouldn't do what you do with your gaming rig or setup. Doesn't make anybody dumb or stupid.
If I was doing something wrong, I would definitely hope you would tell me.
Well, what's the other alternative? Because for me, this connection I have with Xbox Live is, like I said, when I say it's about the experience, it includes me and the group of gamers I have been gaming with since like 2002, 2003.
So it's more of an emotional investment.
It's not an emotional investment. It's there. It's the emotional investment. Microsoft provides the games that our audience likes. Anybody you know that plays on Xbox that actually is a hardcore user of the console, they're using it. Like I don't know what I got like damn near 80 360 games. The subscription fee is minuscule. I buy games that cost that much that are bullshit. Like for example, when I had a PS3, I probably should have bought the Plus subscription instead of Uncharted. And that's how I see it. I would have been better off buying that and getting access to everything that's great about PlayStation Plus than that game. It was a throwaway game. On Xbox, I bought, what was that? What was the name of the game? Too Human. That game was $60. I bought it brand new. That's the same. I could have threw that away. That's the way I look at the subscription fees. See, that's the thing. It's nothing. I spend so much money on gaming that the subscription fee either way is nothing. Now, and like I said before, the free games are great.
My main
problem.
That's
not why I buy the system.
My main problem with Xbox Live is that they have features that shouldn't be locked behind the pay gate.
Like the Netflix and that type of stuff?
Yeah. Like okay, Netflix, the DVR feature. That stuff shouldn't be locked behind a pay gate.
All right, well, I'll explain that to you. This ain't me taking a shot at you. I'm not trying to say you're dumb. But, like, this TV right here, I can do Netflix without a problem, just like anybody else. My laptop has an HDMI in it. I can do Netflix without a problem. It's about the experience. And I believe that's what's, again, all the bullshit about what the way the company's bringing it. Yeah, we should stand up for ourselves. But you pay for what you get. The service incrementally improves over the years. Now that they're talking about using more cloud processing, cloud computing, these things are all going to begin to come whole into the life cycle of the console. For example, when the 360 first launched, all it did was play games, DVDs, and the music that you put in the disc, CDs, and that's it, online, that's it. I've been an early adopter before. I've been gaming since 85. I've been an early adopter before. We're just in a different.
Yeah, I had an Xbox. I had an Xbox 360 when it first launched as well. I had bought like maybe three or four Xbox 360s. It started out good. I paid for Xbox Live for about, I think, a year and a half, and then I was just kind of like, I'm like, what am I paying for here?
Well, I was paying before the 360 came out. See, when when the particular gamer, I'm 32, so I'm like right in that sweet spot of the market. When I got into Xbox Live, I already had the original Xbox. So I was playing Mech Assault, playing Halo, Halo 2, all that, Ghost Recon, Rainbow Six, all of those experiences were on Xbox Live. And that carried over into 360.
And PC.
Well, it was already on PC. PC, my first online PC game was Duke Nukem. And this was back in like, no. Well, yeah, online, actual online play, not single play.
See, that's why a lot of what Microsoft does with like their Xbox 360 and Xbox One, that's why a lot of it doesn't make sense to me, because other platforms do the same things for free, for less, with more value, or just, like take the PC, for example. It just doesn't make sense to me how Microsoft charges for Xbox Live, when the only real features that they actually govern is like the achievements, the Xbox Live store, and some P2P servers for the chat rooms for, party chat and everything, which is why when I was on Xbox Live, we constantly got dropped from our party chats because of those P2P servers. I fucking hated them.
Well, I live in Ohio. I live right by a university and a hospital, so I don't have that problem, but I see where you're coming from. But yeah, I mean, a lot of that comes down to other things that aren't necessarily tied directly into the console, because at the time that you were going through that experience as far as a home console was only on that system.
And not only that, bro, but games for Windows Live was the same thing as Xbox Live, but for the PC.
But well, that's because Microsoft as a company, they divide everything. Everything is like divided. Now, you know what? I'm not saying that I wouldn't want that to change. But the people that buy into that service, they buy into it. Like, for example, people have gym memberships, right? Some people don't do that right either. And I agree. People that do Xbox Live, if you pay $60, hey, eat a glass sandwich. You're dumb, okay? You need to go ahead and get into, like, Amazon.com, Costco, whatever. Find a way to get a cheaper deal. Don't pay the $60. Don't get raped. There is ways to get around it.
Xbox Live, what they offer is just—it's just not worth the $60 that they're charging. Like when they moved it from 50 to 60, I couldn't believe it. they announced what was it, like an NBA feature?
No, wait, it was ESPN, and that ESPN feature is very popular. You can't minimize these things. Feature is very popular, and
Microsoft gets paid for these features.
Yeah,
they get paid from the. Pays Microsoft. ESPN pays Microsoft.
Yeah. What's wrong with that, man?
When Microsoft is capitalism, getting money,
value for value.
When Microsoft is getting dollar. Money for these features, why are they charging you for the features?
It's value for value. When that feature came out. When ESPN came out on 360, I love sports. I like to, that engages me. So that was something else to use with my console. You can't get that experience on other systems.
So why is Microsoft charging you for features they're already being paid for?
You don't get it.
I do get it. That's why I'm asking you.
No, you don't get it. Why would you ask me that after I've already explained that I know what I'm paying for? I'm paying for them to actually provide me with
you're
the experience.
You're paying for an experience.
And what are you paying your internet services fee for? What do you pay your cell phone bill on top of all that? See,
I pay my internet so I can access the internet.
None of this stuff can be given to you for free. There's always a trade-off. For example, with your PSN. The free game.
Netflix can be given you for free because...
You still have access to those games. Say if you have a bad couple of years, and you want to play those downloadable games, can you still play them?
With PlayStation Plus, no, you cannot. The only games you keep are the ones you actually purchase on discount.
All right. So that's why I kept my 360, because those Games for Gold games, I'm downloading those to my hard drive. I'm keeping them. And if I decide... to not use Xbox Live, I've got a library of games I can just boot up and play.
Games for gold.
But listen, the games are not just, they're mine. And the games are not bad. It's got Dead Island. You've got what, Gears of War was one of those. Are actually good games.
Really, really old games.
And so are PSN games. Really? Or PS Plus.
I think last time I checked, you can play Outlast on the PS4 for free. You can play Uncharted 3 for free. XCOM. And a few other newer games as well.
But what if you only paid for 2 months? You only can play for those 2 months.
Well, then play them while you have time.
And that's the way that is, right? It's acceptable, right?
Well, you pay for a subscription, and
you pay. What if you didn't like the games? What if you only downloaded 2 or 3 games?
Well, next month there's a whole nother set of games for you to play.
Exactly. So because that's the way their service works, right? That's how they provide the service, right?
And it's a good value.
Microsoft has a deal with NFL. They have the ESPN deal. They have things that are more than just gaming that bring you in. Now, that's where the value of Xbox
Live is. The way that works is that Sony pays the developers a set amount of cash so that they can actually offer their game on PlayStation Plus for free for however long
it's out there. Whose money is that they're using?
The money they make from the subscriptions and every other venture they have on the PlayStation.
Right. And without that, they wouldn't be able to give that experience, right?
Who knows?
Right.
Because these companies make a lot of money in other venues besides the online subscriptions.
Right. Like, and PlayStation gamers.
From everyone buying
a PlayStation gamer, like, for example, when I get my PlayStation, it's going to be for the games. My Xbox console is my media hub. And it's my game system. I play so many hours of Duty, Call of Duty, all of these games. Hours upon hours upon hours. And now, everything is married with the Xbox One. See, the type of consumer that they're going towards is not necessarily the kids that need somebody to buy a console for them. They're going towards guys that are looking for that experience. The guys that have what I have here, a man cave, and the best TV that you can afford for yourself and optimize towards that experience. See, even though the games on Microsoft, this is something else I want to talk about. I feel like we beat a dead horse over the services. But look at the games. The games are not necessarily full 1080p like on PlayStation, but they look damn near comparable. And Xbox gamers like myself, I don't care which console sells the most copies. I just want the best experience. I've had problems with the online, but that's about 2% of the time. My internet connection is awesome. I'm always online, and I'm paying for that experience.
Paying for
now, I mean, what's your argument against that? Why should I not?
There's no argument against that. I'm just saying
Why is that wrong for Microsoft to ask you to pay for the value of what a consumer that consumes their product should pay?
Because it's not a good deal for the consumer.
How so?
Are we referring to the console itself or for Xbox Live?
The console is Xbox. It's all one experience now. You're not getting the console without Xbox Live now. Just like most people that are hardcore.
So what you're telling me is that no one's going to buy the Xbox One unless they're going to get Xbox Live along with it.
Why wouldn't you? We already know that you should. See, Sony catered to the gamers that are online and offline. I'm not saying that's wrong or bad. But those offline gamers still need to go through things to get their full experience. There's games that come out that need the update on the disc. You have to go through that. If you got to email Sony, you got to call Sony to get that done. See, with Microsoft, you pay the subscription service, you're in there. With Sony, you pay the subscription service, you're in there. Why buy offline? Why buy the console and not expect to get the full experience? That's what the Xbox One is.
So the Xbox One pretty much was made to sell Xbox Live.
What do you think? And the Kinect the Kinect itself is a part of that full experience. Like, I use the Kinect now without even noticing it. Now, you remember Illuma Room? Now, this is just my hunch. Now, this is how we should discuss ideas or hunches, I guess. Remember Illuma Room?
The what room?
Illuma Room. It's they sold it off last year. I think it was at CES. It's a hologram or a projection of your Xbox games.
I do remember the name, but I don't really know much about it.
Okay. Well, for example, it uses a camera. It actually expands the game around you 360, like all the way around you, like through the projection. Like, so say if you're looking straight on at your TV, mm-hmm. you'll actually be able to see peripheral and above the picture on the screen because of Illuma Room. So the Kinect is not just an extra add-on. It's also a platform for possibly a platform for an additional gaming experience that they're going to provide down the road.
Like Kinect Rivals 3.
Like, maybe. Like Illuma Room, like for example, if you're playing Battlefield. Like what you need to do is actually look into it. Actually, absolutely. For example, the dancers, you could see them on the sides of your TV projected along the wall.
And that's what Kinect will do. It'll project images.
No, you're not even listening. What I'm saying is the Kinect itself, the reason why it's packed in, the reason why it's a part of this, if you've been paying attention to what Microsoft has been doing,
is because it wouldn't sell otherwise.
No, that's actually not true. I'll give you an example. Do you remember how many the original Kinect sold? How many single units it sold?
25 million.
Exactly. Right on the money. That's a market. That's a viable market, right?
And how many total Xbox 360s were sold?
Now, okay. Yeah, about 80 million. 83 million.
Okay.
So now, this is what I'm getting. Now,
what's the math on that?
Okay, no. You're missing my point. You're trying to make my point before I make it. I brought up this topic. Let me finish. Let me finish the thought before you just go to the woodshed again. What I'm saying is that the people that were buying that bought into it. Okay, they bought into the service. They bought into the device, and it was viable. So the reason the Xbox 360, when it launched, it was $400 for the premium console. And when Kinect launched, it was $150 for the bar. So if it would have came all in one, it would be $550. So the Xbox One is that all in one at once,
$550. You froze.
Are you still there?
You froze there.
Is it back?
Yeah, it's back now.
Okay, sorry about that. I don't know what that is. But basically what I'm saying is, it's included now to help because there's such thing called standardization. When the Xbox launched, it launched without the Kinect. So when they developed it and brought it out 2 years later, the economics wouldn't have been right because it would have been too expensive for anybody to buy. So they basically had to usher in, and they were coming from behind anyways. But that's a different topic. But what I'm trying to say here is the Kinect itself is a platform for the next increment in their features and services, which is Illuma Room, which was showed off last year. And without the platform for it, without standardization, something for people to connect onto already out there, it's going to be harder to launch that. And such a product like that, you're going to have the initial peripheral or the stage already set.
So now you have Microsoft package Kinect to make sure they could bring out more products for their consumers and stuff like that, right?
Yeah.
So then why was Microsoft at the advertising convention telling advertisers how they could actually watch people to get information so they could sell the information to advertisers if they were just doing it to deliver stuff for their consumers?
See, what that is, that's called advertising. See, when you actually set out to entice advertisers, they need to know what is going to be there for them to reach their customers. Now, using the Kinect for that, you can cut off that feedback. If you don't want to share it, you don't have to. Same thing with your YouTube page. Same thing with your phone. Same thing with your email. If you don't want to share your information with their partners, don't share it. It's something that's been going on for years. And whenever you sign up for something, it asks you, check this box. There's nothing different. You're demonizing it.
Well, that's also another thing on these consoles. It is not just the Xbox, but unless you accept the terms, you really can't do much else with the box.
Okay.
So you don't really have a choice but to accept their terms.
No, you don't have to accept the terms for the media sharing. See, as a matter of fact, if you go to the settings, it's right here. It's right here. If you go to the settings, you can cut off feedback.
Well, I'm not just referring to just the Kinect feedback. I'm just talking about.
Well, you said why did Microsoft tell their marketers that they could use it, the feedback from the system?
Well, it wasn't Microsoft's marketers. It was just a convention where all the advertisers come together.
Marketers, advertisers.
Microsoft was there to tell them how Kinect could actually, watch
exactly.
How people looking at commercials.
And what I'm telling you, Jamin, is you can do that with anything. But if you want to play to this audience out there that's wanting to demonize anything, make something up out of and dumpster dive for everything, yeah, you can word it like
I'm
that.
Just saying, but because you're telling me Microsoft package it, Kinect. No, I'm just saying, it, no. You're telling me Microsoft package the Kinect for the gamers and what they could bring to the gamers. But and I'm just saying, if that's true, they wouldn't be over in the advertiser's lap acting like a loving kitten.
You act like nobody else. Listen. You act like nobody else has advertisers. Is that true? All the products you use don't have advertisers.
You have to understand, those were not Microsoft's advertisers. No. Telling advertisers gathered.
Just hit an hour. Listen, you're over-demonizing Microsoft.
I'm not demonizing anything. I'm just bringing up a point that if what you're saying is true, they wouldn't be over there with the advertisers telling them that they can sell them information.
Listen, every company does that. And just like I gave you a list,
also,
you know this already. You're taking advantage. No. You're using negative sentiment when there isn't any. See, I could say the same thing about my phone. Google shares my information with, HP, and HP sends me emails when they have deals.
Well, you don't have to use Google.
Huh?
You don't have to use Google.
You don't have to accept, exactly. You don't have to use the system. And if you do buy the system, you can go to the settings.
So if I don't want Kinect, then can I buy an Xbox One without it?
No, you can't.
Why not?
Because it's not packaged that way.
Is the Kinect absolutely, what's the word I'm looking for, necessary to use the actual console?
No, it's not.
So why am I forced to buy one?
Well, can't you buy a cell phone? Can you buy anything today without accessories to it?
Yeah.
Wouldn't it be cheaper if it didn't have the accessories in most cases?
Well, when I buy a TV, I get a TV and a stand and a power cord.
You don't need a stand.
Okay, well, then I guess Microsoft's
console is what it is. You don't want the Kinect because you wouldn't use it, but from my point of view, you should. That's why you've got people that buy PlayStation 4s and buy the camera additional.
You just told me Kinect wasn't necessary.
They bundled it in there. It's okay if you don't like it, if that's your opinion. I'm not arguing with your opinion, but your opinion is not the fact of the matter, and that's the problem.
The fact of the matter is that Kinect should not be packaged with every single Xbox One.
I don't mind, though. And the people that are buying it don't mind.
I know you don't mind. And those who might have already been forced to buy it probably don't mind. Or probably
you're not forced to buy it. You don't have to buy it at all. You don't. See, that's the thing. You don't have to buy it. But you will buy it.
Can't have an Xbox One.
What you're doing is you're tainting gaming by shitting on the experience. People are buying it because they know what they're getting.
I'm just saying.
The people that don't want it,
the
people that don't want it, they don't have to buy it. I don't buy Apple. I don't buy iPhones. And you also don't see me jumping and hooping and hollering every day about their policies. I'm not interested.
I don't buy Apple either for similar reasons.
Okay. But I do buy Microsoft. I do buy Sony. You do buy what you buy. I don't get, if I'm not going to buy it, if I'm not interested in it, I have better things to do.
Also, so regarding the Kinect.
For example, the group that we're in, what's it called? Gaming Battlegrounds, which is started by somebody I totally respect far as what I've seen them post on the Facebook, I don't know anybody directly. I don't have any necessarily direct people that I can say I know before that group in there. But what the issue is, the things that people say, the articles that take advantage of the fact that of the ignorance of the average gamer today, that's what gets under my skin. And that's the way they package this product. If you want them to change it, if you don't want it, wait and see if they put it out there without it. Don't buy it. Maybe that'll make them change. But constantly in the hamster wheel with it every day, to me, that's whack.
So you don't think it's wrong for them to package a peripheral that people don't want with their console?
Look, last generation, when they sold the 360, it's called standardization. You're overlooking this, and you're smart enough to get it. When they put out a console, the core, without the hard drive, and later on it was needed for things people wanted to play and use on the system, it wasn't a good idea. They found out the core was not marketable. It wasn't right. So the Kinect is a stage, or it gives them the standardization for the way they're going to improve their services, including that in the future. And it is about that. For example, I subscribed to BG, and it was hard as it took everything I had not to make a response video, because he said he never uses Kinect. Like, if you never used it, you're spreading negative sentiment about something you don't have the experience with. And that's why I called you a phony or a fraud.
But you told me now that Kinect is not necessary to use the console.
It's not anymore. They had to strip that. Again, they did listen to people, but they're still going to bundle it in. And the reason why is, again, because of standardization.
It's because no one would buy it otherwise.
I think people would have bought it. I actually do. And I had no problem with it, to tell you the truth, because of the reasons that we're discussing now. I had no problem with it because I don't mind paying for what I get. I'm not sitting back expecting a company to give me a value for nothing. I got to spend, you got to pay to play. And PlayStation's catching on to that now.
PlayStation is not forcing me to buy peripherals that I don't need.
Want the full experience on both systems. It's like going two different directions on a track. If it's a circle, you're eventually going to end up in the same place multiple times. So if you're paying for the full experience on both systems, you're going to pay. If you want to play multiplayer, you're going to pay.
As I stated before, the Kinect only had a 31% install base on the Xbox 360.
It still was profitable enough for the market that it reached out to. It's like with the balance board, the Wii balance board.
And it only had a 1-to-1 attachment ratio.
Exactly. Look at the people that buy the games on, like, right now, you can't really judge. Because Sony is like,
On average, people only bought one game for the Kinect. And I've gone to pawn shops recently, and those things are full of Kinect cameras.
Well, what about
mountains of them?
You can find stuff like that with the Move too. That's every game console, pawn shops, and secondhand stores.
I didn't see any Moves in there, probably because no one bought a Move to even sell back to a fucking pawn shop. Move didn't do well at all.
Right.
But so there's just
that audience is taking control of the rhetoric at the moment. And nothing about the console that is following up, or nothing about the experience, is the same philosophy anymore. The philosophy of Sony has flipped. They've taken on Microsoft's policies, but telling everybody else that they're not doing it and they're for them.
What Microsoft policies have they taken up? Besides making people pay to play online.
That's one.
What are these other policies?
It's not just about the policies. It's also about the
Told me that they're taking up Microsoft's policies and we only have one.
Well, that's the main one.
What are the other?
Really,
I
don't have a list.
What are the other? Lesser main ones?
What I'm saying is direct. They have taken on a yearly subscription, and it's for the same reasons Microsoft has done it. It's so they can get an advantage with the publishers and advertisers. That's really what it's about. You know it. I know it. And it's also why you haven't taken the plunge. But I tell you, I have taken
the plunge because
and I do. Yeah, you haven't purchased a next generation console yet.
Because there's no games I really want for either one right now.
I'm That's happy all
right. with what I got right now. I got a PC and I got a PS3.
And nobody's raining on your parade. I'm not doing that. What I'm saying is you're spreading negative sentiment without necessarily considering the full picture.
What negative sentiments am I spreading?
Your whole persona.
My persona. My aura. Mm-hmm.
Not your aura. No. Whoa. Even like, for example, you see the actual, what I'm referring to is the bullshit on internet, how, you know, the different media outlets are slanting everything to the point where you're not even thinking twice whether or not you're.
I'm not talking about media outlets. I asked you, like, what negative sentiments am I spreading?
Oh, anti-Xbox news.
Yeah, and what if I said that's wrong in those?
Majority of everything.
It's negative. I can't make something that's
made negative. For example, when we just talked about Microsoft having a meeting with these advertisers, you think Sony doesn't have meetings with advertisers? You think Nintendo doesn't do it? You think only Microsoft did that for the Xbox One?
Can you show me where Sony and Nintendo have gone to advertisers telling them that this camera we have put in people's living rooms and bedrooms can be used to spy on them to see when they're looking at commercials, to see what kind of
products they purchase? They didn't say spy on them. What they're saying is you can use the camera for that particular customer, and it's already being done. It's not necessary. It's already being done in other devices. So you're having people all
acting like the sky is falling. What other devices are having cameras used to look at what people are looking at for advertising?
What other device is that sophisticated to be able to do that?
Well, you told me other devices are doing it, so I'm asking you what other devices are doing it.
Well, there's TVs that do it.
There's TVs that watch commercials, and they send information back to advertisers.
Your cable box does it. There's a hard drive on there. There's a connection. Your internet searches do it. Google, Bing,
What other devices with a camera are watching you and looking at
you? The only one is the Xbox Kinect.
But you said there were other ones.
What I'm referring to, there's other forms of monitoring that you're already involved with. That's what I'm saying.
Those other forms you can avoid. You don't have to
use. You can avoid Google. This too.
Yeah, you have to disconnect it and you have to turn it off.
You might have to do that, but look, I'll show you.
But if you're going to just disconnect it and turn it off, you shouldn't have to buy in the first place because it's not a necessity to operate the device.
Right here. You can cut it all off. You can cut all the features of sharing your all off. It says clearly. Do you want to share your information with our partners? No. It's that easy. Just like with your email address. You want us
to do
that?
So why do I have to buy it? Why do I have to buy a Kinect camera?
I've already explained it. I think that you think that
Microsoft says so.
I think you think it really gives you an advantage to ask the same questions over and over again. What I've already explained to you is more. It's about that's the way that product comes bundled. Period.
It's for Microsoft's benefit.
It's not. I use it, and other people use it. There's people that are doing the fitness, the Xbox Fitness.
But if I don't want to use it, and I just want to use the Xbox,
and that's your opinion.
If I just want to use the Xbox console, and as you stated, the Kinect camera is not a necessity to operate the box, then why can't I just buy an Xbox One to play the games? Why can't I just buy an Xbox One and just buy Dead Rising or Forza or whatever other microtransaction games that I want?
Because that's not the way the Xbox console is engineered
to operate. So I'm forced to buy a Kinect camera.
You have to buy it. Yep. Yeah, let's go ahead and say that. Yep. It's a media hub and it includes a camera. Yep.
Well,
there's
media hubs available.
Have you had an epiphany with that?
There's only...
No,
I'm just saying there's other media hubs out there that don't have cameras.
And you can buy those. But what I'm saying is you dedicate, you should already know this. Well, so you dedicate hate and perpetrating that you're a gamer when it's all right. You don't have to. You can skateboard without having to go to a skate park.
I'm not perpetrating hate. I'm just stating the truth, the facts of the matter.
But no, but you're still making it out like the people that are involved with it are just retarded or they're X-bots, and why do they do this? The reason why it is done
they're
is because
you haven't even invested. They say
you haven't even invested in the experience
things.
For yourself.
The experience,
but you kowtow. You actually kowtow to the Sony gamers, and you do.
In what way?
Well, with being so anti-Xbox, period.
Why am I anti-Xbox? What have you seen me say about the Xbox One? What have I said that's wrong about the Xbox One?
You already know. The majority of stuff you've had to backtrack on. And
like what?
I can't hear you.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, okay.
What have I had to backtrack on?
Well, you had to backtrack on the features because Microsoft changed their policy.
So that's me backtracking, not Microsoft?
No, it's not. Microsoft backtracked too.
How is that?
But they did it.
They did it for the way they're doing business. How was that me backtracking? They changed it. That's not me backtracking.
No, we're off into the woodshed now at this point. Well, what I'm saying here, man, is Microsoft, your negative sentiment towards the console, you're spreading negative sentiment without all the facts. People listen to you without understanding, and they just go along with what you say.
Well, here, we'll do this. I'll look at some of my videos. Once I see the title, I'm pretty sure you'll know the contents of it, and we'll see if we can find some of these negative sentiments I've done that require experience. Let's see. Microsoft running games on PCs at E3.
But wait a minute. See, at E3, not every company you're not mandated to be having your final hardware to be running.
Yeah, but that wasn't the point. What did Microsoft say they were running their games on? They said they're running these games on Xbox One development kits. But instead, they were PCs that were not even on AMD graphics cards, but NVIDIA, that were a lot more powerful than what they even had advertised for their Xbox One. And that was the main point.
I didn't see that.
Well, you can Google it. It's all there. That was my main point in that video, is that they outright lied to everybody's faces. Why do you think games like Forza 5 look so much differently than what's actually released?
Have you played it for yourself?
No, I haven't.
So you're going off what you're told, on what somebody else telling you.
Do I have to play a game to see a difference between fully rendered people moving
on
the sidelines and cardboard cutouts?
You do. Yes, you do.
Really?
Yes. Yes, you do.
Wow. Okay.
You won't catch me going and saying, looking, this is like tabloid media. That's like tabloid media.
You just told me that to see a difference between what they showed at E3 and on the Xbox One, I have to actually play it, when I was also referring to the differences between the crowds. If you watch the E3 video, you see the crowds actually moving. Like, they're all fully rendered individuals who are cheering, jumping, waving.
You can't see everything through YouTube. Now, no. What I'm saying is this. You can't necessarily
One release, they were just cardboard cutouts that were just still and just...
Did you play it? Did you see that for yourself?
How about I play it for everybody? How about I play it right now for everyone so we can all see what I'm talking about? So that you won't have anything else to run around with. Oh, darn it, YouTube.
All I'm saying is this, man. I believe that, you know, Microsoft, no company has ever had perfect E3s. Sony hasn't had perfect E3s. A lot of the stuff they did wasn't right either.
Well, I'm done referring to just like
the E3. At the end of the day, how far did
the downgrade go at this point? The downgrade, the lies, the deceit.
Like what? I don't understand. Like, they, I don't. Listen.
All right, since that's you, not working.
Where, how old were you at E3 2005?
Oh, man. I was probably 16.
Okay. All right. I was much older than you at that point. I was about 23 or 24. And I was disgusted that Sony showed phony footage of Killzone 2. Disgusted. I had been seeing that and experiencing it for two generations already, okay? But you know what? I still bought a PS3.
You bought a PS3 for $599 US.
No, I didn't.
Okay.
I waited for MLB 2010.
Okay, so you waited a while. All right, cool. Because I didn't even know the PS3 came out until like 2007.
Yeah, it actually came out in 2006.
I actually had to start working at Blockbuster to find out the PS3 came out.
I was working for a major bank at that point, and I had money to throw away, but I didn't want to buy $600 because I looked at it like, oh, they're just trying to bring Blu-ray in, and I just want a pure gaming system, right? And at the end of the day, I ended up enjoying Blu-ray and liking it and paying $35 for Blu-rays, paying for a larger TV every 2 or 3 years to further my experience. Those games were good. I went back and played some games like MotorStorm. I really couldn't stomach Killzone, but that's a whole different topic. But at the end of the day, each of these companies offer their own experience for their own reasons. I was totally disgusted that Sony was working so closely with movie companies to print discs to sell to me, a gamer who wants to play games. And so I actually went and bought the system.
Did you have a 360 at the time?
I had a 360 2 weeks before the release date.
Did you buy the HD DVD drive?
No, I didn't.
Okay.
You know what? I was gaming on a high-definition 1080i projector at that point because no TV I could purchase was cheap enough and had a big enough screen at that point. So I went and bought a 1080i projector for my 360, and it was a glorious launch. And all we had to play was Call of Duty 2 and Perfect Dark and Madden. And a month after that, Street Fighter.
Well, okay? YouTube is. What I'm saying is,
you got to have these experiences and enjoy these systems for what they are. And this whole it's like, I think Cliffy B said it the best. This is an online metagame.
Don't use any quote from Cliffy B, please.
I fuck with Cliffy. He put out the set. He said straight up that all these articles, this is what's going on, is a metagame. So who can drum up the most negative information? When it really is supposed to be about the games. If it's all about the games, everybody out here knows you play.
Cliffy's enjoyed responsible for a lot of negative information.
What do you mean?
Cliffy was the one who said that anyone who's tech savvy enough to upgrade or to use a PC can download games and install. He had these stupid things he said about piracy and the stupid things he said about the PS3.
Okay, I'm not trying to say Cliffy B is Jesus. What I'm saying is when he talked about this negative sentiment in video games, it's the bullshit. And that's what I'm talking about.
I think he's saying that more because no one really likes him.
I don't give a fuck about that. It makes sense. when you look at websites like N4G, and you look at all these, and you look at these groups, and the people are posting everything from biased sites, Xbox Super Dude, and Dual Shockers, and all this stuff is from these websites taking advantage of the fact that we're not gamers right now. We're media sluts.
Well, it doesn't really matter where the information comes from as long as the information...
Yeah, it makes a big deal.
As long as the information they give is correct. You can read an article and you can see their sources and you can make the judgment for yourself whether or not this source is legitimate enough or not.
Exactly. But these companies are also, they're click farmers, man. You look at the website and it'll have like a one paragraph and it'll be something like, Sony is 50% more powerful than the Xbox One. And that's not true. It's not 50% more powerful. They're comparable or they're about the same.
Well,
there are people who are running with that, and I got people asking me in the real world, because I mean I don't know if people talk.
You're about saying that the Xbox One and PS4 are comparable when it comes to their specs.
Yeah.
So why are there so much more 1080p 60 frames per second games on the PS4, and why are multi-platform games coming out at higher resolutions and greater frame rates than on the Xbox One?
What I'm saying is, those games.
There was an article recently where a developer stated that the Xbox One's eRAM is what causes a lot of problems for the Xbox One and why they can't get the same graphical fidelity.
I don't know why you would think PS RAM would be a difficulty when it wasn't a difficulty with the 360 last generation. They just don't have the drivers because they, for whatever reason. But let me answer your first question. Let me answer your question. Why are there more 1080p games on PS4 than Xbox One? The main reason is because their drivers are more mature. But even though the drivers are more mature and the Xbox isn't, they're not using the full potential of what's
available. Microsoft a software?
Let me finish the thought. Let me bring this around for you before you jump in. This may be why we're having a communication problem. The games are still comparable even without use of the full system. Are they not? If it's 50% better, shouldn't we see a larger gap than just frame rate here, resolution there, frame rate here, resolution there? And we're not seeing that.
Well, that was only like one developer that said that. And I don't really care what they said because even I know it's not 50% more powerful. Even I know that.
Exactly.
The PS4's GPU is only
pushed around like it's a fact.
Well, that's... Well, are you actually trying to make a point because silly people believe in silly things? Like, I don't really care about that.
Yeah, they believe in silly things because they can find people that support their silly opinion.
Okay. If that's what they think, why does it matter? They're obviously wrong.
Okay, I can live with that. Why does it matter? And that's why I've decided, like, after this debate, first of all, I have no personal issues with you or nothing, dude. You know, if you do jump on Xbox One or PS4, I'm more than willing to fuck with you on those, play games with you on those systems. I don't want to get any language strikes here. I'm more than willing to do
that. It doesn't matter. Don't worry about it.
Okay, cool. I'm more than willing to do that, dude. And I actually like this conversation because we can actually, you know, have it without the BS. That's what I'm saying. That's the BS is going on out here, and I don't believe the Xbox is that bad of a console. And the people that own it, the people I know that own it, are enjoying it as much as me. And same thing that belong with PlayStation. I'm in the barbershop, dude, and I'm like, I'm see they're playing 2K up on a big 60 inch on the wall, and I can't see the joysticks. I'm like, y'all playing, the game, and I'm like, yeah. And I'm like, I got a game. I need to get this. And dude was like, what you playing on? I said, Xbox One. Oh, NSA box. You know, like immediately, like.
Well, what are you scared of? People are passionate about their platform of choice.
And you can take advantage, like stuff like that. To me, like, you're taking advantage of the fact that they're ignorant. People that believe in like conspiracies, to me, are people that look for excuses for why they aren't where they imagine themselves to be.
My main problem is not, you know, websites taking advantage of gamers and getting clicks. My main problem is the companies that take advantage of gamers. That's my main thing. That's why, you know, I'm so against the things that Microsoft does. That's why I don't like what Capcom does, or EA, or Activision, and that's my main thing. I don't like what they do to gamers.
And I support what I like with my dollars. You know what? I got beef with Capcom too. You came out with like 12 Street Fighter games. Who needs that? I don't buy sports games anymore because it's the same thing over and over again. They might as well release a patch instead of the game every year.
Pretty much.
So I don't buy those games for that reason. Those are couch games for me. Those are games that, you know, I'll only play if somebody's sitting next to me on the couch. I don't tell people that's, you know, they're dumb for liking those games. I don't create nicknames for those people. For me, that's just overboard. I could if I wanted to, but you guys don't play shooters or RPGs. You're not gamers. You're dude bros. But to me, it's like a waste of time. And like, we'll be arguing. You'll pin or peg somebody something on somebody that's not even true.
Well,
people can't even have an educated conversation because automatically they're an Xbox.
Well, I call people Xbox based on the things that they say.
Oh, yeah, there is Xbox out there. Don't get me wrong.
Based on what they say and what they do. Because I have seen some stupid things said by Xbox fanboys. And that's like my main thing. Like, back to what I was talking about before. Like, I'm just for the gamers.
See, look. My videos are posted. BBC,
tell
him COD is lame. He'll piss himself. As a matter of fact, I actually have not played this Call of Duty as much because Call of Duty needs to step it up. Yeah, but it's not going to piss me off because I own the game. I know what it is, and I'm not going to disagree with the straight up truth. But you got people that think that would affect me because the whole social fabric of this shit is just everywhere.
Well, I don't, like, what people say, like, about me, like, I don't care. Like, that shit doesn't faze me. And I tell people the only thing that will faze me is when it's some shit said by someone that I actually love or that I know personally, like my girlfriend, my mom, my dad.
Yeah, family's off limits, period. Family's off limits.
I don't care what anybody else says, but I will entertain people who say stuff and ask them, like, well, why do you say that about me?
Okay. Yeah, and me too. That's my thing too. I go after that thing, and you're so opinionated. That's why I said, you know what, let me go in here and show you that the way it's there's a way to go about getting these companies to bend to us without turning us on against each other. We could use each other as gamers. I don't know if you know about the BitBag, Shut the Fuck Up and Play. That's what that whole True Gamer Network is about. It's about us still being
gamers. That's how we got to do it, though. We have to educate our fellow gamers, and that's the main point of my channel. I have to tell people what's wrong and what's going on so that they can know. Like, I see in the comments section all the time people who never think about these things the way I think about it. And the way I explain it, it makes sense to them, and it clicks. I change people's minds all the time.
Like,
that's my main goal, is just to educate my fellow gamers on what's wrong with gaming. And all I ask from these companies is to give us a better deal, give us better options, more freedom, more flexibility.
I get what you're saying, but you're not investing either. You're not buying the consoles.
I'm not going to invest in something that's bad for gamers. I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to support a company.
They'll be more inclined to listen to you.
I'm not going to support a company that rips gamers off.
I don't, like I said, they're not being ripped off, man. That's your opinion. Microsoft has a more popular and a larger service as far as Xbox Live because gamers don't feel ripped off. They're buying it.
Well, they don't really have a choice at the same time. Because as you stated before,
if you buy the system, is that not your choice?
If they don't buy Xbox Live, they pretty much can't do shit with their box.
But if you buy the system, is it not your choice to accept that? Just like with PlayStation, you're not going to be able to accept multiplayer without paying the fee.
Yeah, but
that's get a little kick for it.
But on PlayStation 4, you can still play online multiplayer games that are free to play, like Warframe, like War Thunder, like Elder Scrolls Online. Those are, you can still play all those are games without games playing for paying for PlayStation Plus.
No, no, those are great games, but they don't do it, man. They don't do it.
Well, they don't do it for you, but for others, they do.
Right. I wouldn't say that, but I'm saying like for the hardcore gaming community, the new adopters, that's not getting it, bro. You don't see people hype about game night on Warframe.
Well, I don't really look for people hyped up on game night for Warframe, so I wouldn't nobody see does. That. But it's the same. I know plenty of people play it.
It's the same thing with Rise. Plenty of people play multiplayer, but the sentiment behind it is, oh, it's horrible, so why even try it?
Well, I wouldn't buy Rise because I don't agree with the microtransaction aspects behind it.
You don't have to buy
anything, but I still don't support that. I don't want microtransactions on the back end of the games I buy. I don't want that.
But what is Warframe?
Warframe is a free-to-play game.
But you can?
You can buy things.
Uh-huh, and it's basically play to win, right? Pay to win.
Well, I haven't played Warframe, but from what people who played it tell me, it's not play to win. That you can buy, you can get everything just by just playing the game.
Exactly. Same thing with Rise, pretty much.
But the point of a free-to-play game is that usually they get their money through microtransactions or advertising.
I haven't bought anything on Rise. Everything that I buy in the game is with the online arena cash I earn from playing the game.
I don't buy games with microtransactions on the back end for the simple fact that I don't want developers to get this idea that...
But you say, hey, Warframe.
Warframe is free to play.
But there's microtransactions.
Please tell me, how are they going to make money from a game that's free to play if they don't give you something to buy and they don't have advertising?
I get the philosophy, but you're still going to purchase into it, right? So it's the same thing. I purchased Rise. We just got there. We're getting there. We're going around the same track. We're just getting there at different points. Either you can get it free and buy everything or take years beyond your interest to continue to play the game to get everything, or you can buy it, enjoy it for what it is until you move on to the next thing.
You're still confusing Rise with Warframe.
If you spend $60 on Warframe, I'll give an example. If you spend $60 on Warframe, you'll have enough equipment and upgrades to experience, you know, complete and total, that full experience right away. And you can do the same thing with Rise. You pay your $60, you get the full experience right away.
Look, free to play games.
If you want to buy the extra stuff,
free to play games with microtransactions are okay.
It's optional. It's optional.
And it's optional with free-to-play games. And the same is applied to Rise. You don't have to buy shit in Rise.
How many free-to-play games
have people? My main problem is that when they have microtransactions in there to where people can just max themselves out immediately if they want to, and everyone just takes little shortcuts. Like, they take the value out of actually playing a game for a long time to earn things. It doesn't make sense to me.
You can do it either way. Here's the thing. I'm not trying to sell you Rise.
Microsoft,
I'm just telling you that
they started this last generation on the Xbox 360 with these crazy little microtransactions with games, like on Tales of Vesperia, where you can actually buy levels so you don't have to go out and grind. That doesn't make sense to me. RPGs are about grinding, fighting, leveling up, and playing the game, but if you tell somebody that they can get a system and play
free to play games, that in order for you get owned in Warframe without any purchase, you can do it, but it's not, you're not with those guys, you're not getting down without making a purchase unless you are excellent at the game.
I've played plenty of free to play games before. Like me and Shokio, we used to play Ragnarok Online a lot. We used to go down that fucking game. We played that shit hardcore. And there was items that people could donate for, like special equipment, that made them pretty fucking powerful. We didn't have that shit. And it was like a player versus player server. We still destroyed their ass every day without that shit. And eventually, when someone gave us those very same items, we pretty much went from just destroying their ass to just being untouchable. Because not only were we already powerful, it didn't really matter. Like,
yeah,
they'd come up to me, they just miss. And I'm just sitting there just like, yeah, motherfucker.
So besides our difference in opinion, just to make my point, I guess, without no BS behind it, all these companies presenting us different product, and really they can only do what we allow them to. And I just don't like my hobby having so much minutia. That's really all. And I actually, dude, you do a better job at this than the majority of people that try. So I my hat's off to you for that, man.
Thank you. And just my main thing is that I don't want my hobby to turn into what it's currently turning into. And it just doesn't look good. Like, already, like, all the big games on Microsoft's platform have microtransactions. Like, this is already, like, this is why I don't want people to support that, because I don't want this microtransaction trend to proceed, because once
but
they
not
do
every,
it,
it's
and
going
it's
to
okay,
stop once
everybody else will follow suit.
Once it's going to stop because gamers are buying the games, but they're not participating. Almost everybody I know that bought Forza is not purchasing that unless they just haven't talked to me about it. Like, they're just not buying into it. So that's another way to vote with your dollar. You're still going to play. You know, it's like going to the arcade and they had some games were 50 cents, some were 75. If you didn't play the 75 cent game for a couple of months, it'd be 50 cent. You know what I'm saying? They'll bring it down. So it's the same thing with games.
You just really shouldn't buy it. If it has something like that in there, you just really shouldn't buy it, because that's what sends a message. Like, it's great that you just, you know, you bought the game. They made some money off of that. But out of like a million people, if 100,000 people buy a couple of items, that's nothing but pure profit. And that's going to encourage them to continue doing what they're doing. And I just don't want, like, last generation, what we saw was DLC go through the fucking roof. We had on disc DLC
for the early adopters.
No, let me
DLC
finish. Let me finish. They had on disc DLC where they were locking content on the disc, and you would pay $5, $10, $15 to unlock something you already purchased physically on your disc.
Yeah, I don't agree with that.
DLC went crazy, and people kept buying that shit, which is why it got that bad. And that's why I don't want gamers to support these games that we are seeing with all these microtransactions, because it may be something small now, but that shit's going to get worse later down the road.
It's already bad as it can get. I mean, look at your cell phone. All that shit is just all microtransactions. It's already bad. It's already bad, dude. And also, even, you know, I don't really like the microtransactions either, but if I like an experience of a game, I still buy it. I'm an early adopter, and to me, Rise is that setting piece. Like, if you come over and I show you, hey, this is what this is about, I'm going to show you Rise. Show you Rise and probably Battlefield. And it looks good. It plays good. I enjoy the game. And I don't have – just like you can ignore the fanboys, I can also ignore the microtransactions. It's just what it is. You know, I haven't paid for any additional content besides the characters for Killer Instinct. If it's to buy, I'd rather get killer points to get it. I challenge myself that way. I don't like to cheat. For me, microtransactions are like a cheat. I'd rather earn it.
And that's another thing, man. Just like, that's like the whole idea behind my channel, is that things that are not good for gaming, I got to talk about. And like with the microtransactions, what they're doing now is that they're catering to lazy gamers who don't want to grind, who don't want to earn things, you know, by putting in some time. Someone actually told me that I don't have time to play a game for like 30 or 40 hours to earn this car. I can just spend $60 and get it. I'm just like, you just pay double the amount of the game.
I agree.
A single car, man.
And you know what sucks, though? Like, I do like Call of Duty a lot, and the only thing that's keeping me from trading this one in is the fact that I am a premium subscriber. If I wasn't a premium subscriber, I probably would trade this particular Call of Duty in, because the experience that they set a standard for, they are no longer meeting. And I believe that we should stop buying their games until they actually give us, you know, what we pay for with them.
And that's what I'm saying. Like, I don't want people to, you know, because what Microsoft is, a lot of what Microsoft is doing, I don't agree with. And that's why I don't want people to support them, because I want that to change. If Microsoft made all the changes that I would like, selling the Xbox console without the Kinect camera, you know, there's already rumors that they're going to sell one without a disk drive. And that's just, that shit just doesn't make sense to me.
But like, check it out, though.
I'm like, why take out the disk drive when people don't want the camera?
Do you agree with the Steam box?
Oh, well, there's like a ton of different Steam boxes that you can purchase. So you can find one that matches your criteria.
But here's the thing. They are marketing to that consumer.
To what consumer?
The consumer that will buy a discless game console. Excuse me.
Well, they're basically just selling like PCs to run Steam. That's pretty much all.
What is PlayStation Now?
It is a online streaming gaming service, like on live.
Exactly. And that's all right, because they're catering to that market. There's people out there that may not be able to afford a TV and a game console, but if you bought a Bravia and you could access great content, that's awesome. I mean, that would be great, because that, I mean, like, I like my TV. Like, say, in 3 years, if PlayStation Now is really that good, maybe I'll buy that and pay that subscription. Because it's not necessarily about them ripping me off. It's about me knowing that the publishers and the people that support these products that enrich my experience in my holodeck here, they get paid for what they do. Do I want it to be $90 a month? No.
Well, they get maybe paid 15. Already. Like, honestly, Microsoft doesn't have to charge for Xbox Live. They really don't.
No, they don't. You're right.
They make money just by developers coming in to get a dev kit. They make money from selling Xboxes, from selling games.
A cheeseburger at a burger joint should be 75 cents, not $6.
Well, a lot of them are like 75 cents, at least the really bad ones. You can buy a cheeseburger 75 cents, but I can't guarantee
you could, but
what
you're
going to eat is 100% beef.
You better be driving an ambulance when you buy that. Or, yeah, because you're not going to live. $75 cheeseburger in 2014, bye-bye.
I mean, pretty much what Microsoft is selling is like a McDonald's factory line type thing. You know, when you get off work and you drive by McDonald's, you see people just lined up all the way around McDonald's in a driveway. That's basically what they were trying to do with the Xbox One. Just cater to those who are just, they don't want to put in the work, put in the
effort.
Nah,
dude, listen. Are you into sports? Are you into sports? Because I do, for me, I work out. I watch football, basketball, a little bit of baseball. I play games, video games.
Okay.
That's the person they're marketing to. I'm a father of four. I'm 32. Everybody in my house, we surround this system and we get the most out of it. My kids have my old 360. It was on the other side of the room. They're set up over there. We got the Xbox here, the Netflix. We do it all. We get a lot out of it, a lot of enjoyment. And now it does it seamlessly. And there's nothing wrong with that. It caters to everything I do. Everything I do.
For $60 a year.
For $60 a year. And you know what? I've got credit cards with fees that give me perks for when I travel. And I pay them. But I don't have to.
You don't have to have a credit card.
Exactly. But I may take more trips a year than somebody else. Just like I buy more games than most people.
But a console is a lot different than a credit card, because a console is simply a device.
No, listen. when you have a credit card and you have an annual fee, you can get on the same plane as somebody else, but you get to pick your seat first. You know what I'm saying? Your meals may be half off. Or you can use concierge service that can set up your hotel and a ride, your rental car, and all that for you before you get there. That's what you're paying those extra fees for. And with Microsoft, they're catering to your entertainment. They're catering towards the sports enthusiasts, the health enthusiasts.
Well, I can understand a credit card having a yearly fee because they're giving you access to credit. They're giving you access to cash that you don't have.
And Microsoft is a media entertainment company, or the Xbox is, and they're giving me access to the NFL. They're giving me access to ESPN. They're giving me access to my movies.
Every other device gives access to for free.
I actually use the Kinect. I've made a Kinect video. I put up a video using Kinect. Can you hear me still?
Yeah, I can still hear you.
Okay. I actually made a video here using the Kinect, and it's just real amateur. It's just right to the point, nothing special. And here it is. Oh, I can't put the link up. Anyways, either way,
that's the main thing, man. It's just that they're charging you for stuff that you shouldn't be charged for. Plain and simple. That's why I don't agree with the way Xbox Live is ran.
Well, I say, we have different point of views on consumerism. And honestly, we know a lot of people take that route you take. You know, I worked for a bank for a number of years, and I saw people who had $600 a year fees. But they were paying those fees because they were traveling so much. And the fee, that $600, went towards premiums that catered towards their lifestyle. So these are called executive members. So this type of thing is the same thing with, that's why I don't mind paying for Xbox Live. I don't mind paying for Enterprise Rental Club. I don't mind paying annual fees for these things because some of these things, I'm not trying to put off that I'm rich or that I'm not, but some of these things that I pay for, there's a purpose, it's a reason. And it's the same thing with Xbox. And yes, they are catering towards the audience that cater towards what I like. I mean, yes, I'm getting Titanfall. That's awesome. The gamer side of me, like right now, I'm refreshing my email like every 20 minutes. And you can joke about that if you want, but I want that beta. I want that game. And I'll take what they give it because I don't go into hypothetically they could have done A, B, or C. You're giving me what I paid for. The only people that have a problem with it are the people that don't want to pay for it. And fight your fight, but don't piss on my parade. That's all I'm saying.
I'm not pissing on your parade. I'm just saying that they shouldn't be charging you to do a lot of the features.
Why shouldn't they? I'm saying why shouldn't they? You get paid to do your YouTube videos if you I don't know if you monetize. Maybe you have, but if you do enough hits, why should you get paid?
Because what I do is I entertain people to watch my videos, and they put advertisements up there.
So you should get paid.
Yeah, I get paid.
So you should get
to
paid.
To entertain people.
Exactly. And what is Microsoft doing
with
Xbox?
Whether I get paid or not, I would still do it.
Right.
I did for a long time without getting paid.
And that's your philosophy.
Across three accounts because people kept flagging me down.
I would never flag you down, bro. I'm gonna put that out there. I would never, because to me, I don't want to use the system or manipulate to make my point. I'm a man.
That's one thing. Like Xbox fans have never flagged my videos down. That's one thing that I will say. Anyone I've ever debated has never flagged my stuff down, except for the Google Plus Xbox page. They flagged my video down. But besides that, no Xbox fan has touched any of my shit.
I can't stand any fanboy, I'll tell you the truth. I mean, my cousin, like we were raised like brothers. He's had to chill me out like a couple years ago. Like he's like, you're biased, bro.
But I'm like, what? Before you get into that though, let me just finish off what I was saying.
Go ahead.
A lot of these features we have on these platforms on this console, like let's take Netflix for example. Whether you get Netflix on your Xbox, your Wii U, your phone, your tablet, all it's doing is running an application that connects your device to Netflix's servers. That's all that is. And you pay Netflix for that ability to connect to Netflix's servers to watch their movies. So why should you have to pay Microsoft so your device connects to Netflix? when Netflix already pays Microsoft a fee to put their app on their platform?
Because Microsoft is using their own portal. And I'm not mad at them for it. I've actually enjoyed their own the security portal. Of it what for portal are going using? On it's 10
just,
years.
It's just your Xbox connecting to Netflix, its servers.
I've Microsoft enjoyed the security has nothing of it.
To do with that. Microsoft doesn't why touch don't, that.
Why don't they? I don't understand.
Because it's not Microsoft service. It's just your box connected to Netflix. That's it. But Microsoft is making you pay for that feature. And that's all the features on the Xbox. The only features Microsoft runs are the ones involved with your specific gamer tag, with the games that you record onto the cloud, your game saves, the achievements, the leaderboards. That's the only stuff that Microsoft actually does for Xbox Live. Everything else, like the games you play online, not even Microsoft. When you're playing Call of Duty, that's Activision servers. Not right. Microsoft.
Right. And they have that choice. See, but that's the thing.
Why is all these years has Microsoft charged you when you're not even connecting to Microsoft? You're going to
Microsoft has a complete
you're going to Blizzard or whatever, whoever service they are.
Microsoft has a full, complete infrastructure behind Microsoft. There's workers, there's people there 24/7. There's deeper security than there's a big layer there. I mean, I listen to the Major Nelson podcast. I listen to, you know, a lot of Xbox centric podcasts as well as other podcasts that are more neutral. It's the reason why it's there is because they have services. They have people there. They have companies. They have 24-hour customer service. It's there. You're paying for access.
You're paying for access to other people's servers that have nothing to do with Microsoft.
You're overlooking the other premiums. You've got the movie service. You've got the music service. All these are there behind the subscription or the membership.
But why are services that are offered by other third parties behind the paywall?
Because that system doesn't allow you to access online features without the gold membership. That's it.
That's just what it is. Microsoft is the only company that does this.
It's all right. It's all right. I don't have a problem with it because I was going to be online either way. And I say the same thing to PlayStation gamers. If you're going to pay for multiplayer, then it shouldn't matter to you on either system. Because if you're going to pay for multiplayer, you're going to get the multiplayer and all the features on PlayStation. If you're going to pay $50 a year, you're going to do it the same. It's the same. But yeah, you can take
two the options. It's not the same because on the PlayStation, there's multiplayer games you can play.
Okay. See, I was trying not to do this.
They still give you access to every feature on that box.
No, listen.
Except for online multiplayer.
Listen, their system, their features, that system is not as good as it's made out to be. It's not. They have not actually created a solid system. The chat service is not up to par. The features, the only thing, the saving grace is the free games. They don't have any partnerships that are fleshed out like ESPN. Like the NFL Network, they don't have those things.
What's wrong with the chat service?
It's not next generation.
Like, what have you experienced? Like, what does it do when you're on there?
It sounds like this.
It sounds like people are muffled.
It sounds muffled. It's staticky. It's not on par with the competition. It still operates like a free service.
But they didn't have that on the last console.
They didn't. You're right. But people still pay the subscription.
Yeah, but with the PlayStation service, you get more bang for your buck, though. You get a lot more money back for what you
pay. That's if you like those games.
Well, you have games that you can play across three different platforms, as well as exclusive discounts in the store. If you own those,
see, the online system, like, I don't own my PlayStation 3 anymore, mainly because I wasn't utilizing it to the full potential. I wasn't using it for much more than Blu-ray. And the games that I played were, it just, the value just wasn't there.
Then why even did you get a PS4?
Why didn't I get one?
No, why did you get a PS4?
I don't own one yet.
Well, then how can you tell me what people sound like on the chat? And how can you tell me the chat's bad when you don't even have it?
I know somebody that has one.
But didn't you tell me earlier on Facebook that because I don't have next-gen consoles, that I was irrelevant and couldn't talk about them?
The philosophy works the same for you and me. What you're talking about right now
is something that people actually experience by owning it and hearing it for themselves. But you're telling me it sounds muffled and last gen, like a it free is. Service.
The headset they came with was cheaper than a cell phone joint, and the people are totally overlooking that. Now, I'm going to tell you, Microsoft actually has clear, crisp sound over the voice chat.
As we stated already, I don't talk about things that you like specifically experience with these consoles. That's not what I do. I talk about the business side of it, the effects of gaming, what it does to gamers, how much value it has. That's what I talk about. You know,
and look at how many people see Xbox Live as a value. Look at how many people see that. No, they're not. They're not wrong. You can't say that.
I can take a service and I can show you how it has value. And I can take a service and tell you how it does it based on
what's the fee service you know has value? Tell me one service you pay for that has value. What would you describe that as?
A free service that has value?
No, a paid subscription. What would you pay for, or what subscriptions do you have that you say are valuable?
Amazon Prime.
Because it's going to be your opinion.
Amazon Prime is a great value.
Not to me, because I don't order enough.
But they have streaming movies all year round. New movies, old movies.
Not interested.
And plus, for the amount of shipping you pay, you get free 2-day shipping for a whole year.
Mm-hmm. And I probably don't order enough to equal $80 a year. And you know what? I used to work for
2 days.
I had association with how that works. And it's not the value you think it is. People cancel that stuff 24/7.
Amazon Prime is a great value.
Okay.
Netflix
and
is a great value.
You pay for it and you get what you want out of it, right?
Yep, I get free 2-day shipping on anything that I purchase. And
I know how it works.
I get movies.
I know how it works.
It's a great service. Hulu is a great service. Netflix is a great service. Great bang for your buck right there.
I have Netflix, and I agree.
Those are great examples of services that are great value.
Okay. And you see the value in those, right? And you also see that it's subjective.
How so?
It is subjective because I personally do not see the value in paying because I don't use it to that extent.
Well, if you don't order things from Amazon, then to you personally, it won't have value.
Mm-hmm. But
for what they offer,
mm-hmm.
that's a value.
Right.
I'm not just talking about from my own experience, just being able to have two day shipping for free on any item that you order within an entire year is a great value. Because shipping on Amazon is pretty fucking expensive sometimes. And you can bypass all that.
I'm not saying
that. You can make the value back.
If you ship with Amazon, if you order at least once a month, it may be a value for you, yes. But I will probably order from Amazon 2 or 3 times a year. And that is not a value to pay $80 a month for that for me. But I do purchase dozens of video games. I do stream movies from Netflix and also use Redbox and all that. And I like to take something with me like that. I can do all that all in one place. And I have friends that game the way I game and the times that I game and the games that I play on. And it's a value for me to be able to stay connected to them. I've got family members that the first time they saw my kid was through an Xbox camera. And it was definitely worth the experience. It was worth having the access.
So you're paying and getting a value so you can people can look at
it. Exactly. I use it for what they intended for, yes.
You know, you could have done that on a PC for free.
I could have, yeah, but at that point, I didn't own a PC that was powerful enough or had the features to do it.
To run a camera, just a regular webcam?
Yeah, yeah.
You don't have a PC powerful enough to run a webcam.
I do now. At that point, I didn't. We're talking about a kid that's 6 years old now.
Are we talking about the first Xbox?
I'm talking about the 360.
The 360.
And the first Xbox, the value is there because there was no other online service with the other consoles. There was one with PlayStation, but it was dial-up.
In 2005, you didn't have any kind of computer powerful enough to run a simple webcam.
I had a computer, but I did not have a webcam because I was not investing in my computer. My computer was for paying my bills, keeping up with the news.
That same camera, though, that you use for the Xbox will work on the PC as well, though.
I know that, but I used it for my Xbox console. What's wrong with that? Shit.
There's nothing wrong with it. It's just that you're using that as an advantage for what you got out of your
it
Xbox.
It was. At the time, it was easier to sit on the couch. It was easier to sit on the couch and say, hey, check him out, than it was to go over to the computer and plug it in and move it around.
On the 360, he was in the military. Did you have to pay for Xbox
Live
to use video chat?
You had to pay to do the video chat.
On the 360.
Yeah. Sure did.
Wow. That's I didn't I probably knew that, but there's just such a long list of things locked behind that pay gate that I forget sometimes. But regardless, you could have used the camera on the PC.
I could have used my cell phone. I had a Nokia at that point that would have been just as good. I could have just whipped that out and said, hey, no, but I used my Xbox because he was on a military base. And he was gaming at that moment. He was taking a break. He said, I heard you got the baby. Yeah. Clickety click. Here he is. Still sitting on the couch. Check him out. It's about the experience. And that's the thing. People pay for that.
So using video chat is part of Xbox Live's value.
That's a part of it because that's access to it. It puts it right here in your living room. Or today, I wouldn't have to do that. I use my laptop.
Video chat is a part of value.
So are you saying that
for an online service that's free everywhere else?
Yeah. It was a value at that moment. It was convenient. It was there. It was connected. I'd already paid the subscription. It wasn't just the camera. I'm not saying that's the cherry on top. That is the pinnacle service. You know, I'm saying that it's a part of the whole package. At the same time, ESPN was rolling out.
Are we talking about the Kinect camera or just the regular Xbox little tiny camera?
It was the Vision camera.
The Vision.
Well, I'm talking back when you were probably still catching a bus to school or whatever you did to get there.
Drove my car.
Okay.
Man, high school. Oh.
See, I was a grown man at that point, and I paid for what I play with. And like today. And when I'm ready to get a PlayStation 4, it's going to sit right here next to my Xbox One.
Well,
and I'm going for everything I can.
I just can't really take you seriously when you say video chat on a paid service.
I was just sharing an experience with you, but the option is there. If I had, it would have been whatever. I'm just saying that's just the way it is.
And if you had any other device, the option would have been there as well.
Exactly, but I didn't. I did not have a webcam, and I didn't want to unhook the one on the Xbox and take it over there. You're making something it's not.
I'm just saying that, you know, it's great that you're able to do that. But my main point is that
That's not why I would tell you to buy an Xbox. The only people that I would tell to buy an Xbox, and this is me keeping it 100, are people that are really into video games and multimedia. if you spend most of your, if you want to watch movies and game and all that at one place, then do it. Honestly, I wouldn't tell a grown man to go buy a 360 unless he is into Halo or Gears of War. Because I mean, being the best,
if someone wanted to play games and have a multimedia center, I would tell them to buy a PS4 because they can do all that for free.
Right. Unless they're into what is available.
You don't have to pay a subscription to use the service that you pay a subscription for.
Numbers of guys I know have only bought PlayStation consoles, right? Only bought PlayStation consoles. But when they came over to my house to play games and chop it up with me, and we're playing Madden or we're playing whatever we're doing or Call of Duty, and I cut on ESPN right there on the couch without... Yeah, I could just use my cable box and just switch inputs, but the fact that it was on the console, the fact that you get access, like the presidential debates and things like that were live feedback was provided for Xbox Live members, that's an exclusive experience in your living room. See, it's bigger than what you've minimized it to be.
I mean, I'm not knocking it. It's great, you know, and you do realize that your Xbox is running the software that connects to ESPN and to the presidential debate, whether it's hosted by CNN or whatever. All that is done with zero expense for Microsoft.
That's fine with me. But what I'm saying is, like, I consider myself to be a savvy Xbox consumer.
You're paying for services that Microsoft doesn't run. It's just software on your box.
They have a pay gate, and I'm all right with it. What don't you understand about that?
What I want you
when
to
I get the PlayStation 4, am I
you,
not going
to
have
to? What I'm trying to get you to understand is that they're making you pay for things that you shouldn't have to pay for to use on your platform. Don't you?
I've
agree?
Got all those options either way. But what you understand
don't
about
you
me
agree?
And most gamers that game on Xbox, we already have those options. And I buy the Xbox because I like that experience. Yeah, it could be free, but also if you want to look into it, there's a reason why it's not.
Because they want it to be that way.
Well, you might not like a certain brand.
Pretty much the only reason why it's that way, because it's just incentive for people to get Xbox Live and pay that $60 a year, because that's like nothing.
They do give back
pure profit. Nothing
they give back, bro. Like, I'm telling you, if you get the rewards program and you pay attention to your emails, you know, you can get, like, I've got back, last year I got back $40.
How does the rewards program
you the cash.
Work?
Yeah, it's a rewards program.
How
some
does
of them
the rewards program work?
All right, well, for example, say if it's, say, they'll send you an email, they'll say for the month of February, if you watch so many hours of Netflix, we'll give you a rewards credit of, say, a dollar or something like that. Or for every, if you download these three movies, we'll give you back A, B, or C. There's something to pay for. There's something to get into it. It may be something, one of the features. Or you play a certain game.
So
it's just promotional.
It changes
every month.
You pay $60 a year, and that's the only way you can get the Xbox Rewards program. And they reward you for using applications that you shouldn't have to pay for, like Netflix, that are available for free on every other device in the world besides Xbox 360 and Xbox One. And they give you $1 or $2 a month credit to spend in the Microsoft Store.
And it's a good experience, too. Honestly, the games, the connectivity, the library of games. Like, I'll give you an example. Like, look at the fact that Sony themselves has begun to cater more to the multiplayer audience. And people aren't putting a magnifying glass on the fact that they are coming out with next-generation games that are not that 60 frames per second standard that people are setting. That's a false standard. And you can't tell me that nobody's ever, ever enjoyed a game at a lower resolution than 1080p or less than that. It's just all BS rhetoric, man. You've enjoyed games like that. Left 4 Dead, it was rendered in less than 1080p.
On 360?
What is it rendered in on the PC? Inform me.
Whatever resolution you want.
Exactly, because it upscales, right?
No, it's native.
What's the native resolution? What is the native resolution?
Whatever you want it to be. It's all native. They don't have it set to a single specific resolution on the PC.
Okay, that's because the PC is an open system. Consoles are a closed system. If you're paying, see, to get what you're getting for these consoles, and you're willing to pay $400 or $500 to get it, you would have to pay much more than that to get it on the PC. Okay, if you buy a PC, you're going to get a bigger experience. If you're buying an Xbox or a PlayStation, you shouldn't be arguing about resolutions, because these things are the price of a decent graphics card for a PC. So the PC elite's philosophy has spilled over into this console world, and these guys don't even really get it or understand it. The 1080p upscaling is still almost just as good as the 720p or 800p or 900p. It's still just as good, and it's not a locked 60 frames a second. It's a varied 60 frames. It's unlocked, and people are running with half-truths.
I've had this same discussion with Hip Hop Gamer.
What?
About upscaling and 1080p resolutions.
Yeah. Well, Hip Hop Gamer is I respect him, and I've actually had discussions with him myself. So I'm not going to talk bad on Hip Hop Gamer, okay? What I'm going to say here is I have my own opinion, and looking at these games on both systems, the Xbox version is equal to every game on the PlayStation 4. It may have deeper specs, but it doesn't change your... The PS4 may have better specs, but it doesn't change your enjoyment of the game. It never has. If that was the case, the PlayStation 4 wouldn't... Excuse me. The PlayStation 3 wouldn't have launched, if that meant everything. If that meant as much as people are putting a standard on it for.
Well,
I'm going to tell you right now.
It was a big deal last generation when multi-platform games were at a better resolution on the 360 or a higher frame
rate. I'll tell you why it was a big deal is because the 360 was less powerful by a long shot than the PS3.
Well, the main thing with the PS3 is that it had that crazy-ass cell processor, which made development on it incredibly difficult.
Okay. And in this generation, what's happening?
The PS4 has better specs. And it's easier to develop for.
Okay. And the games are still comparable. But see, the difference is with the PS4 is, see, when you got a TV that...
1080p and 900p aren't comparable. 60 frames per second and 30 frames per second is not comparable.
Actually, yes, it is. You can't see above that. It does look a bit more fluid. I'm not saying that it's not a better frame rate or that it wouldn't be welcome. What I'm saying is being overemphasized as a benchmark, and the same people that are using that talking point have accepted less. So it is bullshit. That's what I'm saying. These same people that are doing it. See, talking shit
generation. You know, between the 360, PS3, and the Xbox One, PS4, I don't really care what resolution these games run at or what the frame rates are. The fact of the matter is that it runs better over here or it's a little bit less over there. That's all it is. And people are just using it as like points against the competition. That's all it really is. And if people want to do that, I don't care. But it does show the difference between the two hardware.
And that's also why, like, you have to choose who you cater to as far as your audience. That's why one thing I disagree with you on is you actually take the audience and embellish, like say, hey, these people are better over these people with your angle. But that's cool. You can do what you want to do. Honestly, I mean, get your money. I'm referring to your support of the ponies. You support them. They're all in your. They're all in your. I'm looking at the chat right now.
I don't watch my little pony.
You.
Are you talking about bronies?
No. I'm talking about the Sony ponies.
Oh.
If you look over here at the chat, just look at the chat. Look at the comments, and it's definitely look who's dominant over there.
Who cares what they say? They're just the audience. If you're playing a basketball game, are you worried about the jeers of someone on the other team? In the audience? No.
Actually, what I'm referring to is whether or not, like, see, if you you're commentating on the two systems. You're influencing people's you're influencing and supporting their point of views. And like I said, your audience follows you. Like, you're calling me TT. You don't know me. And you had other dudes that weren't having that same conversation coming up behind you calling me TT. So it's like, you got these little dudes, they just totally freaking riding you. And they do it because they think that you are down with the Pony Station Nation because of the sediment in your vehicles.
People just like what I say because I explain it very thoroughly. That's the main reason
You're articulate. If you were thorough, you would explain that this may not be new. This is new, but it's not necessarily anything new under the sun. It's new for a game system, but it's not anything different under the sun.
Well, that's what I usually say about most of the things on the consoles. I've always said that the consoles are just getting features that the PC has had for decades.
See? TT just went nuts in the...
Well, don't worry about that, bro.
No, I'm not. Hats off to those guys. I'm pretty sure they think I'm sexy. So it's so cool. It's all right with me. They're just mad because they like me.
Don't worry about that. There's always going to be hecklers, man. Always.
Oh, yeah. Believe me.
No matter what you do on the internet, there's always going to be hecklers.
Yeah, you're right. You're absolutely right. It don't bother me, but I use it as an example.
That's why I like to be places on the internet where people don't like me, because I like the confrontation. I like the arguments. I like to get in people's head and understand where they're coming from and see what they're going to say.
And I do the same thing. That's why I was an adult gamers, but I didn't go to tower gamers afterwards because it was just like a cesspool. You couldn't. I like to troll a little bit, but I'm more into a real conversation. I'd rather have a conversation on it where I can respect your opinion than somebody just jumping off on, oh, you're a fanboy, or not responding with anything but emojis that aren't on the topic.
That's pretty much what the Xbox guys do. Like, every time I have a discussion with them, they just start posting meme pictures.
Well, it's because you say things like, there's no reason why they can't have.
Every time I ask them a question, they just Russell Jimmies, Vladimir Putin.
Yeah, but somebody like me, I'm going to come at you like this. Like, there's no way
I appreciate someone that's going
to come. We can't hold them to that standard without knowing what we're getting.
And that's what, like, people always, like, some of the Xbox guys, they always, like you just said, like, people think I'm in the PlayStation Nation or whatever, or something like that. I'm just for the gamers, and I support companies that support the gamers in a positive way. They do good things and good value to gamers. You know, I like that.
Well, peace to you on that. I'd like to go ahead and end the debate at this point. It's been a great debate. Hopefully we sparked some interesting conversation with this.
I'm sure. And it was a really good discussion.
And I honestly, if anybody who's listening, go ahead and follow me on Twitter, Thunderbird614. I don't do many YouTube videos. You probably won't see me that often unless I get good requests. If somebody gives me a good request for a video, I might do it. But other than that, BBC or Blackbuster Critic, which to me, dude, that name, maybe you can tell me where you came up with it, because it makes me think of a bunch of different things. Most of it is not family friendly.
People call me BBC, and you know it's true though. It's true, you know. As the main reason, how we came up with Blackbuster Critic was that I was working at Blockbuster, and I was known to be a critic at Blockbuster. So I was going to make a YouTube channel where I was going to review movies and stuff. And so my friend Sean was like, well, you're black, so you should be the Blackbuster. And I'm like, that's a good name. Blackbuster Critic. And that's where that name got born. And then people just call me BBC for short. Some people just call me BB. Because they don't like saying.
It definitely
people
is
don't catchy. Like saying BBC.
Hey, it's kind of funny because at first I was like, nah, man. Like, I can't even say this guy's name. But then that's because that's my point of view. That's just some shit I've been doing. You know what I'm saying? But anyways, I'm out of here. It's been real. Everybody be cool and peace.
Yep, major respect to you, man. Appreciate you coming out, bro.
Back at you.
Have a good day.